The slides made available to you contain further tutorial problems for available expressions analysis, and I do not think I would like to explain the solutions. I would leave it for you to work out. The answers are there in the slides. So please make sure that you are able to understand how we get this answer and you try to solve these problems independently, and that you get the same answer as the answer given on the slides. In case you have a different answer, please feel free to get back to me. There is a third tutorial problem here for available expressions analysis. What I want to now do is talk about soundness and precision of available expression analysis, much the same way we talked about soundness and precision of live variables analysis. In order to motivate this, consider common sub-expression elimination based on availability information, based on the information about expressions that are available. Okay, so now we want to talk about spurious inclusion of a non-available expression A star B. In this example here, in this control flow graph here, we have this expression B star C being available, but assume that apart from B star C, we say A star B is also available. This is spurious, this is erroneous, this is an error, and we want to see what impact could this error have. So the first case is when we mark an expression available when it actually in fact is not available. As a consequence of this, an occurrence of A star B, in particular this occurrence of A star B, may be eliminated as redundant because this expression is available. We mark this expression to be available and we have an upwards exposed computation of the expression A star B. This is a harmful error and the solution is unsound. By contrast, consider a spurious exclusion of an available expression, meaning here, please read this as available expression and not available variable. So we have this spurious exclusion. A star B is available here, but somehow our analysis says out of I is empty set, meaning our analysis does not record the expression to be available. Now we have the computation of A star B here. What would happen as a consequence of this error? This is definitely an error because A star B is available, but as a consequence of this error, we will not be able to perform common sub-expression elimination of this instance of A star B. This is harmless. It doesn't affect the semantics of the program. So in this case, the solution of available expressions analysis is imprecise, but it is not unsound. It is sound. So it's okay to say an expression is not available when in fact it is available. It's an error, but it's a harmless error. But it's not okay to say an expression is available when it is actually not available. That is a harmless error and that result is unsound. So based on this, given A2, which is a superset of A1 representing sound availability information, use of A1 in place of A2 is sound because we're simply saying some expressions are not available, which is fine. However, assuming that A1 is sound, use of A2 in place of A1 may not be sound because the additional expressions included in A2 may actually not be available, and marking them as available may create a problem. For most precision, we want to compute the largest set of available expressions. So it's okay, it's sound to say no expression is available, but we would like the set to be as large as possible. Okay, and since availability sets shrink, the confluence is intersection, therefore we choose the universal set as the initial conservative value and let the sets shrink. Use of universal set allows us to compute the largest possible set of expressions that satisfy the criteria. Recall the similar arguments made for live variables analysis. There, a spurious inclusion was harmless. A spurious exclusion of a live variable was harmful and unsound. And using a superset was fine using a subset may or may not have been sound. And we use union and the liveness sets grow. We chose empty set as the initial conservative value that allowed us to compute the smallest set of live variables of the variables that satisfy the liveness criterion. So let's compare some of the features of available expressions analysis and live variables analysis. Recall that soundness requires us to avoid harmful errors, and precision requires us to minimize the harmless errors. So we're talking about different features of these analyses. In case of available expression, erroneous inclusion of a variable of an expression in the set is a harmful error. Whereas in case of live variables analysis, erroneous inclusion is a harmless error. In case of available expressions analysis, erroneous exclusion is a harmless error. Whereas in case of live variables analysis, erroneous exclusion is a harmful error. We will end up not marking a variable as live and end up deleting an assignment which we should not have deleted. The most precise solution also differs in the two cases. In case of available expressions analysis, the largest set that satisfies the criteria of available expressions analysis is most precise. In case of live variables analysis, the smallest set of variables that satisfy the criteria is most precise. And therefore, our initialization is the universal set because we want to compute the largest set in case of available expressions analysis. And it is the empty set in case of live variables analysis because we want to compute the smallest set of variables that are live. As a consequence, our confluence operation, the way to merge these sets, is set intersection in case of available expressions analysis, and it is set union in case of live variables analysis. Now we want to examine the effect of boundary information and initialization on a solution. Recall that in case of live variables analysis, we had seen the role of initialization of a solution. We had a simple example where we did the initialization with empty set and we got a precise solution. And for the same example, when we did initialization using a set contained variables a comma b, we got an imprecise solution. We want to examine the same issue in case of available expressions analysis. We have a carefully designed program here where we have expression a plus c being computed here and a plus c being computed here, and we have an assignment to x and expression a star c is computed in this block. So let's assume that our bit vector, in our bit vector, a plus c is the first expression and a star c is the second expression. Now we want to consider all possible combinations. We want to consider boundary information as empty set and initialization as a universal set. The second combination that we want to consider is when boundary information is empty set and initialization and internal nodes is also empty set. The third combination that we want to consider is when the boundary information is universal set and the initialization at internal nodes is also universal set. The fourth and the final combination that we want to consider is boundary information as the universal set and initialization as empty set. So let's take the first case. In this case, we are saying that the boundary information is empty set and the initialization is universal set, which is the way we have defined available expressions analysis. This analysis tells us that expression a plus c is available at the entry of 2, but it is also available at the entry of 3, and both the expressions are available at the exit of 2 and 1. Note that the expression a star c is not available at the entry of 2 because a star c is not available along this path. Similarly, for node 3, a star c is available along this path, but a star c is not available along this path because our boundary value is empty set. We are assuming that no expression is available. This is the expected solution of available expressions analysis. Now let's assume that we chose the same boundary info empty set, but instead chose the initialization as empty set, unlike the universal set in the previous case. What happens in that case? In that case, we find that the expression A plus C, which was available here, ceases to be available now. That's because our initial value associated with A plus C at the exit of node 2 is 0. We assume to begin with, because of this initialization empty set, that A plus C is not available here. And therefore, when we take an intersection of the information that's coming from here and the information that's coming along the back edge, we find that expression A plus C is not available. So our initial estimate, our initial guess that A plus C is not available here was too pessimistic, because of which we miss out on the availability of expression A plus C in node 2. Expression A plus C is not available even at the entry of node 3 in this case. Now let's look at the third situation. The third combination says that we are marking the boundary information to be universal set, meaning we are assuming that the expressions are available at the start of the program. If we have these global, if we have only local variables, this obviously does not make sense, but we want to see what would happen if we were to make that assumption. If we make that assumption, then it turns out that both A star A plus C and A star C are available at the start of 1, and therefore both the expressions are available everywhere. This is an erroneous result, because we know that along this path, actually A star C is not available. Finally, if we consider the boundary information to be universal set, but initialization to be empty set, we miss out on the availability of A plus C at the entry of node 2, because we pessimistically assume that A plus C is not available at the exit of 2. So that gives us all possible combinations. So the first solution represents the expected availability information leading to the elimination of A plus C in node 3. Note that expression A star C is not redundant in node 3, because A star C has not been computed along this path. So this solution is what we expect, and that's the combination that we have seen before. The other combination misses the availability. The other combination misses the availability of A plus C in node 3. So we say that expression A plus C is not available. We have seen before that this is fine. This is an error, but this is a harmless error. However, here we make A star C available in node 3, although its computation in node 3 is not redundant. So this is also an error, but this is a harmful error. Here, this makes A star C available in node 3, and but misses the availability of A plus C in node 3, which means that this has a combination of a harmful error as well as a harmless error. So we observe that the first solution is sound and precise, second solution is sound but imprecise, the third solution is unsound, and the fourth solution is also unsound. So we make some more observations about data flow analysis. We observe that data flow equations do not require a particular order of solving them. They do not require a particular order of visiting the nodes. We can compute in of node 5 and then jump to node 10, and then compute in of node 2 and then jump to node 20. It doesn't matter at all as far as the final result is concerned. So this is because we are defining data flow equations as a specification. The data flow equations define what needs to be computed and not how it is to be computed. Data flow equations merely relate the adjacent data flow variables with each other. They simply say that this is the relationship between out of the predecessors and in of the successors. How we compute it, in what order we compute it, does not matter. we can use any method to compute and the result will be the same. This is very nice because this gives us a distinction between specification and implementation. We can use a round robin iteration to perform actual computation, or we can use any other algorithm to compute so long as we know that the algorithm computes the final solution of the equations, it doesn't matter. Every algorithm, if it is right, is supposed to give us the same result, which means that the specifications and implementation are distinct. So in this course, we are going to focus on specifications mostly. We will look at the implementation, we'll look at the properties of the algorithms, but for ease of understanding, in most examples, we will take simple round robin iterative method, not worrying about the efficiency or the scalability of the method, because we know that we can use an efficient method and still get the same result. So for ease of understanding, we will focus on the specification. The second observation that we wish to make is the initialization governs the quality of the solution found. Okay, only precision is affected, soundness is guaranteed. And when we talk about initialization, we are talking about initialization associated with the boundary, with the internal nodes. The initialization for the boundary information depends on the semantics of the calling context, and this may cause unsoundness. This is associated with the boundary node and is specified by the data flow equation. It does not vary with the method or the order of traversal. Okay. Now we have still more tutorial problems, which I am not going to explain in this lecture, but I will leave it for you to work out. This tutorial problem describes or proposes a new data flow framework called partially available expressions analysis. We talked about available expressions analysis, where we require the expression to be available along every path. For partially available expressions analysis, we say that an expression is partially available if it is available along some path and not necessarily along every path. Here, the data flow equations remain same as that available expressions analysis, except that the confluence is changed to union and does not remain intersection. Okay. And the tutorial problem is that you have to perform partially available expressions analysis for the example program used for available expressions analysis given before. And now we have the result here. I will leave it for you to work out the result. This is the other program for which we have partial availability analysis, and then we find out whether an expression is partially redundant. That brings us to the end of the second lecture in our module on bit vector frameworks. We stop here, and in the next lecture we will understand the reaching definitions analysis and anticipable expressions analysis.